Sunday Debate with Arnab Goswami, presented by Yes Bank and Kent Aro, powered by Ola. Sunday Debate with Arnab Goswami, presented by Yes Bank and Kent Aro, powered by Ola.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to what I am calling tonight, at least let the hashtag be told, the final Lutyens debate. I don't know if it will be the final one, but I want to start by telling you viewers why we are doing this today. We're doing this today because when we did the first Lutyens debate on the Sunday debate last week, we got some really, really overwhelming feedback. And the sheer amount of responses that we got, in my view, reflected something. And what was that something that it reflected? It reflected, in my view, that there are a lot of pent-up feelings all over the country, really pent-up feelings against what we call the Lutyens or Lutyens circle. These responses range from agreement to vehement disagreement. But many people were generally happy that the conversation was happening and the conversation was directly on Lutyens. And I felt it also over the last few years that whenever you speak about this, we talk about there being an India that has been repressed and suppressed by Lutyens. So, the debate last week and the issues that it brought up. We spoke about politics, we spoke about media. Eventually, the feeling that emerged was that when the British left, they left some sediments, some residual sediments. And the residual sediments created for them a culture of opportunistic aggrandizement. And they were very happy for about six decades till things started shaking up right now. It's those sediments of the colonial mindset that the people of India are now beginning to speak up against very, very, very strongly. But more than just speak up against, uproot. And the greatest thing about India today is that Lutyens is on the verge, if it hasn't yet been completely uprooted. There is a belief that Lutyens won't be uprooted. But that's, in my view, a very foolish view. It's about self-denial, where you believe that we're going to come back. It's Modi's a transitionary phase, and we're going to come back to the way things were. And hence the question is this today, does India hate the Lutyens circle? It's as clearly phrased as that. We have pro-Lutyens and anti-Lutyens in the context of the debate. In the context of the debate, we can open up any issue. Try not to attack personally if possible. If unavoidable, we'll see. And I want to tell you about the kind of issues that I'm going to pick up today. Or let me rather go through it in the course of the debate. What do you say? Let me introduce my guest today. On my right, we have Anand Ranganathan. He's a scientist and author. And to his right is Madhu Kishwar. Very well-known writer, columnist, activist, and founder-editor of Manushi. And to her right is Sohail Seth, columnist, writer, author, managing partner of Council Edge. Remember, individuals do not have to agree at an individual level. But remember, you are a team, and you're facing another team to the left, and may the best team win. We will have constant live polling in the course of this debate, and the numbers will be put up transparently, so debate to win. Rajiv Desai on my left, chairman and CEO, Comma Consulting, political commentator. He veers overwhelmingly towards the Congress while always denying it. To his left is Tavleen Singh. Tavleen is an author and columnist. She's written a book called Darbar, which exemplifies the Lutyens circle. And on her left is Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay, author and columnist. The amazing thing about Nilanjan is that he is best known for his book on Modi while hating everything about Modi. So we'll have to ask him why he's bitter about it or whether he's been co-opted.
Hating is not the right word.
I don't choose my words very... Nilanjan, I don't use my word, choose my words with a lot of care.
Well, I use the word, you know, when it is directed at me, you know.
That's okay.
So hating is not the right word.
I would request you, Nilanjan, in the course of the debate, not to react to me.
No, not react.
It's not hating. It's mild Modi bashing.
Mild Modi bashing. Okay.
Because in those days, one wasn't
coming
sure.
From Madhu, that mild Modi bashing
okay.
is quite terrible.
Can I start the debate? Yeah. Can I do the honors?
Yeah.
And by the way, I have next to me this gong, which I'll use if everything goes out of control. So I start with an observation. Okay, let me keep my observation aside. I give either side 1.5 minutes to attack the other in the opening remarks. Who would like to go first?
You haven't told us which side is what.
Well, this side, well, I tell you this, if I repeat it, let me tell you last time, Sohail. Last time, everyone who ended up and was pro-Lutyens began by with a disclaimer saying we are not. But then I hold reserve my right to place you on the Lutyens side.
We are the defenders of Lutyens Delhi.
You are the representative of the Lutyens circle.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And on the other side are those who take you on.
Are the scum. Proud.
Yeah, we are. Gurugram.
We're the stars.
Gurugram.
Yeah. No, Gurugram is an extension counter.
Okay, let's start. Let's have a serious debate.
Yeah.
Let's have a serious debate.
Well, that's the most serious
who
debate.
Like to, who would like to have the opening shot?
Who takes
1.5 minutes start? You want to start on your side of your debate?
Could I start because...
Okay, 1.5 minutes
of leave. I want to start with an admission that you can confirm if you look at Open Magazine about 8 or 9 years ago. I invented the Lutyens thing. And I feel very bad for having done that. But I did a piece for Prasanna, which said that there was this colonial enclave in India. And loosely, it could be described as Lutyens Delhi. And I actually warned a lot of people afterwards that I apologize to Edwin Lutyens from the bottom of my heart for having done it. But that's how it began. I did that because I'm a child of Lutyens Delhi. My grandfather was one of the builders, even though Sobha Singh's progeny take all the credit. Actually, my grandfather was one of the builders of New Delhi, of Lutyens Delhi, and worked as a contractor with Lutyens Delhi. So I, because I'd seen Lutyens Delhi change from what it was in my childhood, which was a wonderful place to live in, full of beautiful houses, to become a poisonous den for the worst kind of people in India. So I actually invented it. So hence, that's my opening comment. And then, if I have to defend Lutyens Delhi on this team, I shall do it fully, because there are many good things about Lutyens Delhi that are worth defending.
Okay. So thank you very much for confirming my doubts that you are an esteemed member of the Lutyens circle. On the right, 1.5 minutes. Who takes the opening remarks?
Sure.
And then it's a free debate. Please, who wants to do that? Madhu Kishwar, go on, Madhu.
As you started off by saying that, Lutyens is not just a geographical space, it's a metaphor for the colonial hangover that still dominates India in every which way. And it's not just in Delhi that you have this Lutyens physical entity, but every state capital has its civil lines or a bureaucratic ministerial enclave where you will see good roads, where you will see all the infrastructure. Move out and then you see total breakdown of civic amenities and general infrastructure absence, deficit. And it's a zone that represents power, wealth, privilege, flunkyism. It's usually. And actually, if you count, the Lutyens zone in every state capital also would have similar traits, which is it's VIP culture, it's a culture of freebies. You get these colonial mansions for next to nothing. You get free this, free water, free phone, free everything. And it's that parasitic culture and the mentality, mindset of lording over other Indians. The other Indians come to you as groveling supplicants. That to me is the issue. And if you ask me if we were serious about independence. The first thing we should have done is this Lutyens zone should have been museumized or put to better use.
But what about the people?
And no, they should be renting their own homes. Because if, for example, the entire culture of sycophancy and groveling and flunkyism would disappear in no time, and freebies
should
and parasitism, if our bureaucrats and ministers, as in other countries of the world, were expected to rent their own homes, were expected to buy their own cars, pay their own bills, and not parasite on the...
My first point, which I just want to spark off the debate, is when I said Lutyens, the census were you talking about? I use the phrase courtiers, which you use in a different way in your book Darbar, slaves of the Lord. You know, the Lutyens lobby, in my view, Nilanjan, is a lobby of yes men and yes women. It is a lobby that was first in line, Rajiv, in the race to New Delhi and step into the shoes of the British Raj. That's where this whole thing starts. And this is a lobby, to put it more simply, this is the Nehru Gandhi family's Brown Sahib's, the Brown Sahib culture. You know what Thomas Macaulay used to say? You want to create a class of persons who are Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinions, in morals, and in intellect. And recently I saw someone, a particular journalist who in an interview said, that if being Lutyens means I don't want to be Gawar and Desi. This is the kind of phrase that they use out there. So we start by discussing what I feel is whether this group of Brown Sahibs has for years been nothing but courtiers to the Gandhi family, to the Nehru Gandhi family and their generations. Rajiv, yeah, go on.
It's one thing to say that Lutyens privilege has been a problem for India and for all the reasons that Madhu said. But what's replacing it is worse, and that's competitive populism. That's even worse. I mean,
what is competitive populism? When Ammani Shankar Ayyar says Narendra Modi will never be Prime Minister of India, but he wants to distribute tea here, he's welcome to.
I didn't go. I'm not from a privileged background. I'm just a normal.
No, why don't you want to discuss the background? Discuss the real facts.
I grew up in a small town.
You're avoiding my question. Have you all been courtiers
to the top?
Have you been courtiers of the Gandhi?
It's a sort of an American syndrome of.
Firstly, Rajiv, you had no problem when Lalu Yadav played this drama in day in and day out. The point that I'm trying to make is this, that it's not just about tastes and lifestyle anymore. It's about
nobody
whoever.
Is saying that.
I'm saying when a Lalu Yadav manages to get a bungalow in Delhi, his mindset his taste may be desi, but the mentality is that of a sultan.
I think you're confusing a whole lot of issues.
No, we're not confusing. I want to draw you back. I want to draw you in on the issue. I made a phrase here. Why aren't you responding? I'm talking about the kitchen cabinet. I'm talking about the bunch of courtiers. I'm talking about the cocktail circuit. The cocktail circuit, do we agree it exists?
It exists.
A cocktail circuit. I speak on the issue.
It exists everywhere.
Let me phrase here. A cocktail circuit of journalists, bureaucrats, and politicians.
And even NGOs everywhere.
Whether they be the Gujarals or the Nandini Satpathis or Ramesh Tapas. I want to put it very...
Funded NGOs.
I'm asking you whether the cocktail circuit ruled India unfairly for the longest period of time. From Indira Gandhi to Rajiv Gandhi. From Satish Sharma, R.K. Dhawan, Makhanlal Fotedar and Vincent George. To Dodom. No, you will say no. Because you're in denial about it. To Ramesh Tapar, to all these people, is it a fact that this group ran this country and almost felt they had the country by its neck for generations? Sohail wants to come in. Please.
I want to make four or five reasoned points and very briefly.
Please,
Number one, Madhu talked about Lutyens being a metaphor.
Yeah.
Both have fed off each other. The people you call Lutyens and the people who were ostensibly running the country used to feed off each other.
Correct.
The Lutyens journalists that you talk about, whether in a dismissive manner or not, were journalists who were the loyalists. They were the ones who would get the preferred stories. They were the ones who would board Air India
psycho
One.
Fans. Why don't
they
you
were
say
the ones who would
fans.
Get junkets and free houses in the city.
Psycho
Number
fans.
Three.
Why are you being polite today,
no,
sir?
No, I'm never polite. No, I'm actually very polite. Number three, and this is a very important point, is that we've always had a situation where people like us are more acceptable than people who we don't understand because either they are merit-based or otherwise.
You got upset about Jayant Sinha.
No.
No, it's
now, number four.
No, you face the harsh reality.
I think what has happened today is Modi has destroyed the mold that was in existence.
Not yet.
Before you come to Modi, which then brings me to an even more important point, is that we've replaced the word Lutyens with perhaps Deen Dayal. But the Kotri system then perhaps remains.
No, the point is you are avoiding first. Go back into history. Rajiv, go back. I was selling tea, I was doing this. You see, earlier,
you would get nominated to the Rajya Sabha because you were part of, you owed allegiance to one family. Today you get nominated to the Rajya Sabha because you owe allegiance to one ideology.
You know, why don't
you? What is the difference?
There isn't. All I'm saying is that that privilege has been replaced by populism.
Can I put things in perspective, you know, trying to understand, you know, where this debate is really going. You know, it's a debate, you know, I must compliment you that you have actually framed the topic in such a manner. There is a constant overlap of ideas between both sides. We are on both different sides, yet also we are agreeing because it's a very serious issue that we are talking about. The problem in India is that we are essentially given to oversimplifications, creating these hit symbols. We think that if we create this Lutyens idea and we think that we can run it, and then we get confused at who represents this Lutyens. Basically, Lutyens is there in every regime, you know.
You are trying to generalize. What I'm trying to say is that every regime has its own darbar. Nilanjan, I go back, therefore I want to bring you back to where I started.
You are jumping the gun, and I would say the poorest, just one minute. To Tavleen and to you, and to Rajiv, I want to say, the poorest defense that you have is by saying that, yes, Lutyens is terrible, bad, corrupt, morally decadent, financially debauched, but it's been replaced by somebody else. I think that's the silliest argument, because I think we first need...
Let me explain. I'll take you back into history.
First, we need to discuss what we mean by Lutyens. By Lutyens, we mean a bunch of people who had, and their Gandhi-Nehru family, basically, and their sycophants and their hangers-on. I am saying that for 60 years, this country, simply put, is run by a bunch of people who in different ways veer around one family. They get a system of favors, as he said. They are inefficient, they're incompetent, they are not products of merit, they run the most corrupt institutions, and they put their friends in place, and this is like Caesar's.
And what do you think, what do you think these guys have done? Nilanjan,
I bring your attention to the fact, you don't forget how Caesar's corruption in Gaul held on to the fall of the Roman Empire. Don't forget what happened to the Han Dynasty. I am talking today about the corrupt dynasties that ran India for 60 years.
It was in power. I also remember every bit of what happened between 98 and 2004. You know, I want to draw attention to what Madhu was saying, that there is a Lutyens circuit in every state capital.
No, you talk about Delhi. Why do you want to take it away? Why do you want to take it away?
Because she made a very valid point. You know, so
I don't agree with that point.
Why don't you want to talk about Lutyens?
Are you uncomfortable about it?
No, I'm not uncomfortable. Why should I be uncomfortable?
Speak about it.
I'm not part of it. I'll give you a literary example.
Okay.
My education.
Okay. Let me give you a literary example, because I think all of you people are avoiding the subject. And I think avoiding the subject is not going to bring us to the issue. The issue is that their Lutyens means that for 60 to 65 years, a bunch of people had it too good. They were not meritocratic, one. They had not achieved anything on their own. They were all there because, you know, of being the products of the people who took over from the British Raj. And the clearest example today is from Shakespeare. I tell you, remember Macbeth. I'm giving you this so you understand. Macbeth had gone to the three weird sisters, the witches, and demanded that he be shown a series of apparitions that would tell the future. Rajiv, understand this. And today is exactly that. The opposition is exactly in place. One minute. The third apparition shown to Macbeth was a child wearing a crown who promised Macbeth that you cannot lose your battle till the Birnam Wood moves to Dunsinane. Now what you people did was what you must realize is that I'm giving you this example. In this case, Burnham Wood did move to Dunsinane. You did not wake up to the reality that this would not last for so long.
Arnab,
the entire dynasty fell apart.
You're still falling apart. Damn spot.
It's still falling apart. I first want you to, in a very determined way, speak about what happened to this country for 60 years and the fact that in 2014, none of you actually thought that this would happen. Till 2014, Lutyens was in denial. Was it or not? No. About the possibility of a complete changeover.
I actually was invited to Ahmedabad to meet the Chief Minister of Gujarat because I did a piece saying that Lutyens Delhi was afraid that the walls were going to be breached. But I have to say that he has breached the wall. He brought in a new kind of politician, and that was great. And the cocktail circuit and the darbar, etc., no longer exists. Those guys, Amit Shah is not in a 5-star hotel every evening, dining with bureaucrats, etc., etc. That has been breached.
Okay. I go back to it. There was a Lutyens brigade which felt it had been so rooted. And Anand, feel free to come in. Madhu, don't hold back. No. It was so rooted that everything else was a phase. Your problem with Modi we'll discuss later. But the fact is, all the poster boys of Lutyens were all a connection of a bunch of families, some of whom gained from the British times.
And you genuinely
felt this old boys network would never go. It's as simple as that. Anand has spoken.
Yeah, Madhu talked about states within India. It is the same issue with capitals across the world. The old boys network.
When
Cameron Osborne came to power, they discussed the Etonian network.
I'm sorry, you're completely wrong, Sohel. It has not been one family which has ruled any country
in an
old boys network for 60 plus years.
I thought we were talking about a concept, not a family.
The entire concept of Lutyens.
The family has friends like you and many other people who really control many things that they shouldn't have. I control things.
I didn't know that.
Let's not interrupt each other. Let's have a proper debate.
I think the debate, maybe it's time now to take it to the second limb, which is that we all agree that there is this Lutyens thing, right? It is not geographical tag because there is Lutyens, this feeling is there in Chennai, in Mumbai, you know, in all the other places. Might not be to that extent because obviously center holds the power. What we need to discuss is, are they dangerous? Have they been dangerous?
My thesis is
the following. Yes, they have been dangerous. It is because, as you were saying, I mean, all countries, organizations, companies have old boys network. I mean, it'd be foolish to suggest that it is only Lutyens thing.
No, in Calcutta, the Boxwala companies were called that.
Right. And you probably part of about 12 or 15 old boys networks, I mean, you know.
Well, I didn't go to 12 or 15 different schools, but that too I will agree with, in the spirit of harmony and for the debate to continue.
Right. Yeah. What I meant was, I mean, I didn't mean it in a disparaging way. It's like, you know, it's not bad to be networking.
Away from people's
the point
personal
is,
lives.
When does it get dangerous? It gets dangerous if mediocre people, people without any competence, if people who have no expertise, if people who are not journalists but wheeler dealers, peddlers, fake news originators, if they get to hold the reins, they are the first defense of this so-called family you're talking about. Now what has happened, Arnab, as I keep repeating, come on to social media and see the change. It is because their propaganda fails within hours. You talk of anything from Christian fake church attacks to emergencies coming to judiciary under threat to Lynchistan. All these things are being demolished. Why are they demolished? Why are they being demolished? Not by anecdotal evidence, but by hard data.
So I give an example of this. The argument is, and please let's keep drawing back to the subject.
They're not dangerous.
Can I come in?
They are not dangerous.
I want to add one word, and the word is patronage. Yeah, it was so, the power of patronage flowing from one family or one unit into the rest of India, but primarily capitalized by...
I take the example of Khushwant Singh. Yes. Let's talk very straight out.
Don't get me started on Khushwant.
No, I'll talk very straight on this. Is it a coincidence that Khushwant Singh, who strongly defended Indira's emergency and strongly supported the sterilization of Indians and the Holocaust that followed because of it, and said that Sanjay Gandhi is a great intellectual, harsh truth, sir, I'm going to say today, he was considered to be an intellectual by the Lutyens brigade,
liberal,
and rose to great heights during the Gandhi era.
And
so my point is, you have to, so taking forward the uncomfortable truth, and I felt that he wrote Semipon.
He gave up his Padma Bhushan on the day Blue Star happened.
One second.
I was very fond of Khushwant. So, Sohail. I don't know whether he was seen as intellectual, but he was honest as far as I knew.
Sohail, the point here is simple. You can have your views. Let me make...
He was a scholar. Please read his compendium on Sikh history.
Let me make a simple point here. Sohail and Tavleen, uncomfortable truths will be put on
the debate today.
How is it that an individual who supports the emergency openly supports Sanjay Gandhi as an intellectual rises to great heights during the Gandhi era?
Please do not minimize. I agree with Anand.
Was instigated by the
Congress Party. No, don't speak over each other.
I've said it in writing and I'm saying it now.
Was there a group?
The Godhra train massacre, the whole idea of the Congress Party was to unleash mayhem in Gujarat to bring down Narendra Modi. And Congress goons participated as actively as anybody else. There's good evidence.
I'm not an exception. Can I? Tavleen, don't have parallel conversations. Let's speak to each other.
See,
Rajiv, here, debate with this.
Mr. Rajiv Desai.
Okay, can I have two people on the screen at one time? I'm requesting, and two people speaking together, please.
Right.
At the same
Mr. Rajiv
time. I'm on a broader point, and I want you to debate this. I feel you are all skirting the debate. What is the debate? I'm saying that there is a group of people who have no achievements to their credit, but for the fact that differently they live off the Nehru Gandhi family. They have nothing to their own individual credit. Now, they may have professions, but that doesn't mean they have achievements. I'm making a broader point. Oh, I gave the example of Khushwant Singh.
I want to really add to it.
What I want to say.
The reason this got institutionalized, this whole regime of sycophancy and flunkyism, is because a lot of crumbs were thrown at them. For
crumbs
example,
of power.
Journalists got free housing. Plots of land,
good
cars,
point.
All kinds
farm
of bribes, farmhouse, huge number of privileges accrued to you if you carried that press card and you attach yourself to one of the important ministers.
It still happens.
I agree.
Who's taking?
Rajiv, coming to you after.
Okay, one versus one.
Editors get cars in foreign countries from the local embassy.
Let her make a point. Okay, who's debating with her?
Well, I want to make a
Nilanjan
point.
Nilanjan and Madhu.
Why the
Madhu, can I make a point?
Stays?
No, can I make a point?
Because the
I do not think anybody of us here is an apologist for the Nehru Gandhi family. But yes, I want to put it historically.
He is. How do you make that conclusion? He is a complete apologist.
He is.
Well, I can leave Rajiv.
No, but he genuinely loves them.
Okay, guys, listen. Two of you at a time. Nilanjan is speaking, please. Thank you.
What I'm trying to say is that it is not that the past 73 years is that it has been only the Nehru Gandhi family. You know, what I say is that there was a 8-year-long interim right from 96 to 2004 where the Congress was
supported. Government supported, there were Congress
government. The same system continued. The same people and the same type of people remain even now. That is the basic
point.
So the thing is that the system gets perpetualized. The problem is that only one particular political regime is targeted. It is not seen as a symptom, as a disease.
Nilanjan, while you, Madhu and Nilanjan, 1 minute. I find a certain discomfort that you have.
I will
come to the present also.
I
assure you I'll come to the present. But what you need to do, first you need to go back into the past. Give me 30 seconds.
Please.
I'm giving specific examples, you're theorizing.
Yeah.
Rajiv Gandhi's Dun School batch of 1959-1960. They're his friends, rose to power. What achievement did any of them, what quality did they bring? They were only fawners.
But you know,
they were constantly, allow me to complete. Sohail, don't interrupt me. Sohail, don't interrupt me now.
Arun Nehru Sohail. Was a brilliant corporate CEO.
Sohail.
Arun Singh was in record.
Sohail.
These were professionals.
Just one point. Listen to me. Deal with the uncomfortable facts.
There's now no, you can say you uncomfortable can, for un, me.
Uncomfortable facts.
Not at all.
Why do you not want to?
There's nothing uncomfortable.
If it is not uncomfortable, don't interrupt me. Then let me speak.
But it's a debate.
But when I'm making a point here, like I made a point on Goswami Singh. I'm saying, great professionals. Arun Singh, batch of 1959, Chief Defense Advisor. Manishankar Iyer is Public Relations Man. Romi Chopra, Advertising Strategist for the Congress Party.
And all his friends were the top editors. Romi was a great advertising person.
Sohail, if you are switching sides, do it openly.
Yeah. No, I'm making a point.
Sohail, as Madhu said, the players have changed. The mechanism remains the same. Sohail, I'll tell you one thing. Please hear me. I find it amazing today that all I'm saying is the Lutyens circle, which I say are fawners, they've lived off the Nehru Gandhi family, that was 60 years of India. Why are you uncomfortable with that? There's complete denial about it. I'm not uncomfortable with it at all. Now I'll tell you why.
Please answer the question that Madhu posed and I added to and Anand referred to.
Okay, I'll make
which
it.
Is, do we see an India which is rid of that malaise today?
Okay.
No. Are we bereft of it?
Can I explain what are the consequences?
You are not understanding what I'm debating here. Madhu, the question is asked. If you want to brush it aside by saying, yes, it was, but now let's talk about the present. I'll tell you why I want to talk about the past in a little bit more detail. Because of the present. Nilanjan, we must talk about the past, but we cannot talk only about the past. Why not? Because the present is going to determine our future. Why do you want to ignore the past? Okay, Anand is debating with...
It has a pernicious legacy.
It has. You must also talk about the present.
You had Rahul Gandhi about two weeks ago saying that Congress stands for the freedom of expression, right? You had 6 months ago Shashi Tharoor saying if there is any party that has come to the rescue of freedom of speech and freedom of expression, it is the Congress party. Freedom of art lies with the Congress party.
What a lie.
Okay? Now listen, for about 20 years, all we knew was one example, or maybe 10. These are good subject to debate. Adi being banned, right?
Kissa Kursi Ka, five or ten examples. I decided to crowdsource it. Jesus Christ.
You know, right now, there are 225 examples of curtailing, banning, killing people, going on a rampage, banning books, films by Congress party. So let's not ignore.
Should we therefore talk about the present? Anand, that's a good point. Let's not ignore it. You have historians who became Nehru Memorial presidents and they start burning files.
But he's absolutely.
These are emergency apologists. There are people who love Aurangzeb. There are people who love. Can I go back to the past?
I want to go to the past. Yeah. Well, what we're missing here in the whole debate is that the past is always there. And what we did when the British left was we handed India. Okay, not each little state or... We handed India to a dynasty that ruled with an iron hand and ruled... It was socialist feudalism, right? And if we can Tavleen, just be rid of that...
No, Tavleen, I always believe that... Sohail, I'm responding to Tavleen. See, Tavleen... Why am I bringing you back to the past? People will watch this today and I do not want people to feel that you are uncomfortable with my referring to the past because if you don't understand the past, you'll repeat it. Now I'll tell you one reason why. Fact is, and I accuse, I say you, that is the Lutyen circle, you blacked out any wrongs of the Nehru Gandhi family.
Yeah.
Yes. And let me complete this, and I therefore I will bring you to the. I'll give you one example in the context of today. In the context of today, I want to make a point. I want to make a point that the Lutyens League, which you represent, consistently, persistently, symptomatically blacked out any wrongdoings. Let me prove to you this. Tavleen, you have tweeted about how, quote, having lived through the emergency, you said, I want to put on record that in my view, there was one person responsible, Indira Gandhi. Tavleen, how many times did you write about Rajiv Gandhi, right? Promoting the anti-Sikh riots that killed 3,000 people when he said, when a big tree falls, the earth shakes, that was just before the elections. You may write books and tweet about it now, but how many times did you write back in 1984?
The day after the killings, I came back to Delhi. I'd been sent off to Amritsar to see if there was a reaction to not after the killing of Mrs. Gandhi. Mm. On the first, I came back and I wrote an article in the Telegraph, which you could probably still get, and I quoted Iqbal saying, Vatan ki fikr kar, na da musibat aane wali hai. And I wrote in detail about what had happened, and MJ Akbar, who is now with this government, will prove there is
Tavleen, I'll tell you this. I'll tell you this in the present. The Lutyens media then never persistently chased Rajiv Gandhi on the 1984 riots because they were in love with him. I'll tell you one more thing.
I will add something.
I say this, right? Today, Rajiv Desai is sitting here. Today, Rajiv Desai says, Modi draws flak for, despite being a woman, comment about the Bangladeshi PM. That was your tweet. Did you or any of you ever talk about how terrible Rajiv Gandhi was with women on the Shah Bano issue? Was there any hard pushing on it? You promoted sexism, you promoted suppression of the weak, and you promoted violence. I've given two examples. And now the same people, in the context of the present, the same people today feel utterly angry saying this country is going to the dogs. I mean, for at that point of time, you promoted sexism, and even now, the same group refuses to call out Rahul Gandhi or Owaisi and directly tweet against his stalling of the triple talaq bill. It benefits 90 million Muslim women. He is personally responsible. Why aren't you doing it? Because, and I end it here, you want to promote the wrongs of a cozy, privileged cabal, hoping that they will come back. And when they come back, the whole lot of you will come back.
I just want to add
Nilanjan.
Some vital facts related to 84 anti-Sikh pogrom and the Shah Bano case and Rajiv Gandhi's government overruling the Supreme Court judgment. Madhu and I, today we are sitting on other sides. In 84, we were on the same side fighting for the rights of the people who had been targeted in the anti-Sikh riots by that. She would remember that very much, how the entire city, how the elite had reacted at that point, even the media at
which
that
elite?
Point.
Which elite? Who hounded HKL Bhagat? Who questioned Kamal Nath? Who questioned Kamal Nath?
I did.
I think we can take very specific
then or now.
Names.
Arnab, I filed a PIL.
Or maybe then not now.
We can take specific names. We can take the names of Rahul Bedi.
Madhu is responding.
Madhu used to edit. I remember.
Madhu.
Not only was I out on the streets and documented what happened from one neighborhood to another, but more importantly, I filed a PIL in the Supreme Court arguing that since these riots were masterminded right
they
from the top.
They were not riots. There was a pogrom.
They were pogrom. I called it the massacre of the Sikhs, and I did argue they can't be called riots. In fact, Manushi was the first one to say they are not riots because riots would mean killing on both sides.
For the record, the media at that point which brought out the horrific massacres.
For a long time, they called it riots, Hindu-Sikh riots.
Yeah.
Manushi was the first one to use the term massacre.
Massacre.
We went to Supreme Court actually identifying how these were masterminded and led by Congress goons, which I had seen with my own eyes. And the Supreme Court treated the petition with such disdain, compared it to what they did with a bogus, flimsy petition on the Gujarat riots filed 6 years after the riots by Zakia.
So Nilanjan, by the equal measure, Nilanjan, one would also ask whether you are trying to actively black out and play down the emergency when you say comparing the emergency. Listen to me. See, Nilanjan, these things may happen unconsciously, but you leave a track and fingerprints.
Allow me.
I'm asking Nilanjan, why are you so defensive?
What
I say today. Okay, Anand will debate with Nilanjan. Phrase is this, and I come from an overall premise that you want to play down any wrongs of the Nehru-Gandhi family, and you say, how can you compare the emergency to Jallianwala Bagh? Comparing emergency to Jallianwala Bagh is a gross exaggeration. Well, let me tell you, one was a Holocaust and the other was a massacre. The emergency was a Holocaust. It saw the greatest mass sterilization of human men, since Hitler. But the question is, Nilanjan, tell me, why would you try to play down the emergency
by making a comment like that? I do not think that it was equivalent to Jallianwala Bagh.
Oh my God, I don't know.
I do not think that you have a right.
Anand and Nilanjan.
Emergency is completely different.
Oh my God,
there are a couple of elementary points that one needs to make. I think the most primary one is that it is absolutely true that psychophancy has not been obliterated. How can you end psychophancy? There are psychophants everywhere, right? So there is a great deal of possibility.
Every powerful leader likes a psychophant.
Point is, the last 60 years or 65 years or
you
so.
You play down the emergency.
Was there a cabal that was so powerful away from the core political leadership that was dictating the narrative? That's all I'm bothered about.
He's making a point, and I made a point on the emergency. 1 minute. I make a point on the emergency. We speak therefore.
The people of Lutyens Media at that time, because of patronage, wanted to change India's history. They wanted to chronicle India's history differently. That, to my mind, is the most dangerous
disservice. I want to go back to that question I asked Nilanjan. And I ask you, Nilanjan, that I do believe today that the people who are, you know, hold the greatest placards about all the good things that should happen in our country, they all play down everything that was wrong done then. And I'm deliberately pummeling you with that for a simple and singular reason. That I want you to remember what you are promoting. Nilanjan, you are saying to me on this debate, do not compare Jallianwala Bagh to the emergency. 6.2 million men, human beings, were sterilized in a campaign spearheaded by Sanjay Gandhi, who was declared by the prime member of the Lutyens gang, Kushwant Singh, to be a great intellectual. The number of forcibly sterilized men was 15 times the number of people sterilized by the Nazis, by Adolf Hitler. So I therefore wish to ask you, why do you have this slightly forgiving attitude?
There is no question of forgiving
this
attitude.
This forgiving attitude.
This puts the leader of that time, Sanjay Gandhi, in the same league or greater league than that of General Dyer.
Let me put it on.
Why is this forgiving attitude? Where is it coming from?
There is no forgiving attitude. I belong to that generation.
Restraint. I would say it puts Sanjay Gandhi in the same league as General Dyer, because Sanjay Gandhi organized the forcible sterilization of 15 times more men than Adolf Hitler did. No. Why does it hurt you, Sajib?
No.
When I say it clearly, because you were silent witness and maybe fawning member of the Lutyens gang when this happened.
There are hospitals that are called Sanjay Gandhi Hospital.
There are
airports. Every time I go to Indira Gandhi Airport, and I did this morning, I believe that our history is airbrushed. That is what I feel. The architect of the emergency, 150,000 people were arrested, all the laws were, and there is an airport named after her. There are hundreds and hundreds of places and schools and parks.
You have you know, I
what,
want to,
what's going on here? What I meant to say was, it is not the politician.
Madhu,
firstly, it's when you say naming is not important, it is very important.
It is very important.
Because one,
naming is not important.
You iconize one family and you make it appear as if none other matter. Number two, one second.
You are misrepresenting.
Number two, let us speak. Then there is worse to done to other great stalwarts of the freedom movement, of our political life, and anybody who did not support the dynasty.
When did Patel get Bharat Ratna?
In 1991.
He died in 1950. When did Ambedkar get Bharat Ratna? In 1990, he died in 1956.
These are the heroes of the Congress. Every member has airbrushed history, sir. One has to come clean. I love this phrase, airbrushing of history.
Because I'll tell you one more example of the airbrushing of history. And I feel today that people who have done the greatest disservice to India. The greatest disservice to India has been done by intellectual pygmies like Romila Thakbar and Mridula Mukherjee, who have written books, and this truth must be said. I say today, you dare describe Bhagat Singh and Netaji as terrorists in books written by you. I therefore feel that they are intellectual pygmies and they are compromised. I would say today, the only history book that should be written, Nilanjan, who ruined the freedom of expression in this country?
Yeah.
Who? Do these people have the guts to say these same so-called civil society members and academics, one minute they're holding Samvidhan Bichha Bachao rallies today, do they give two hoots about the constitution? Their great icon Jawaharlal Nehru, 18 months into coming to power, amended and reduced the freedom of expression, making it subject to public order. Did they document the suppression of democracy in any one of their history books? Simple question. Hard question here on the program. Let's have a hard debate today. Anand, Nehru said two specific points.
Indira Gandhi's crime is very clear, emergency. In Jawaharlal Nehru, they say, he was the architect of freedom of expression. That he told Shankar, his cartoonist, don't spare me, Shankar. This is the airbrushing of history. He brought in the First Amendment. He jailed Majnu Sultanpuri for 1 year. Because he criticized Jawaharlal Nehru.
And secularism. On the issue of secularism, make a point. Rajiv Desai, confront me on facts if you can. One minute. On the issue of secularism. Today, you allowed secularism to die. I'd say the Lutyens lobby, allow me 1 minute. The Lutyens lobby allowed real secularism to die. There were worst form of sectarian and communal violence in the history of independent India happened under Rajiv Gandhi. And where was the award Wapsi Brigade when no less than Jawaharlal Nehru, hear me and know the facts of history, tried to pass a Hindu code bill regulating Hindu personal laws in 1948, but he refused to make any such laws to regulate Muslim personal laws. That was the death of secularism in our country. Rajiv, answer me on fact. Where was the Lutyens lobby then? This same lobby now wants to lecture me about secularism, about freedom of expression. The two basics were destroyed by this lobby. And just because you were getting favors, all of you remained quiet.
Before Rajiv says,
I accuse you of remaining quiet in that way. I accuse you of selling the country in that way. Before Rajiv says something,
earlier this year, four honorable judges of the Supreme Court addressed a press conference.
Rajiv,
the biggest destroyer of India's judiciary was Indira Priyadarshini Gandhi. When she did what she did, just before declaring the emergency.
Nobody said anything.
So no one talks about that.
Nobody said democracy in danger.
I do not think that you can say that nobody said it. Let me put it on record. The problem, Arnab, is that you have a very unifocal view of history and the protest.
I have a very objective view of history.
Let me put it on record. We talk about
the Okay, fine. Then I'll have to discuss history with you.
You must have a unifocal view.
I'm sorry,
please listen to what I'm trying to say. I'm saying is that it was during emergency. You had glorious tradition of protest from the so-called Lutyens media.
Give me a break on that. Madhu, who's responding?
What are you saying?
No.
What are you saying?
Madhu was taking him on.
Madhu was
going and sending praises of them. emergency.
No, Madhu,
there
Madhu.
Were people.
I have to take him on.
There were people.
Even though you're on my team, I'm ashamed of you to be on my team.
No, yes.
No, listen to me. You're talking rubbish now.
No, I'm not talking rubbish.
Tavleen, you have to look that way and
I'm sorry, Nazar.
You listen to me.
I don't want to listen to you after
that. Indian Express mentioned protested against the Indian
Embassy. I'm sorry. I was actually in the Statesman. For 2 days, we had blank columns where the PIB was censoring.
Yeah. Yeah.
Two days. The Express tried. By the second week of the emergence of press censorship, I was doing a series on hospitals that were censored.
Okay.
We stopped, we realized, and they would give the Statesman back at 8 a.m. There was no, we couldn't fight.
For 2 days, you at least protested.
2 days,
glorious.
All right. So you put it on record.
Glorious.
You are market driven.
I just want
to say. The smaller magazines shut down.
No,
the Lutyens main circle is breaking apart.
The main problem in the emergency was the silence of the media.
Yes.
And it was not just the media in Lutyens Delhi, but the media across in India, because everyone who tried to take anyone on was in jail.
Now my question is, I go to one point. Nilanjan. I am not, you know, nowadays, of course, the fake news is spread that you can't have beef in this country, etc. But I'm not talking about it. I'm not going to talk about supercilious things like how Lutyens wanted everyone to dress the same way, eat the same way, be the same way, behave in that fake Lahore meets, London kind of attitude, where you dress in the Delhi Gymkhana Club and pretend you are from some other country. I'm not going to talk about superficial things like that. I am talking about how the Lutyens circle actually willingly participated in the destruction of this country's great democracy. This lobby was so selfish, viewers. This lobby was so selfish that because they were getting every single favor and they were leading an extremely privileged life, they allowed the constitution to be walked over. And in 1951, Nehru said, if you want to kill this constitution, then call it sacred. Nehru said, If you want to kill the constitution, then call it sacrosanct. In other words, Nehru said, this constitution is neither sacred nor sacrosanct. From 51 to 2014, once did any member of the Lutyens cabal squeak about this? Did they use the hashtag democracy in danger when Indira Gandhi, through the 39 constitution amendment, protected the prime minister from the Supreme Court? When you destroyed the fundamentals of the relationship between the executive and the judiciary, and is it not your responsibility, Nilanjan, not to be co-opted by this group?
Can I have
but say murderers who now want to talk about law enforcement will be told about their own hypocrisy first. Why don't you do that? Murderers who talk about law enforcement will be exposed now. They will not be allowed. You killed everything. You killed the constitution. You killed secularism. You killed democracy. And I accuse you on the program of doing that. Answer me on fact. Where am I wrong?
I think the real crime is, he says don't talk about the past, but even if we were...
The past is uncomfortable, we must talk about the past.
Even if we were to come to the present today, the same Lutyens cable, which defended the emergency and continued to sit in the lap of the dynasty, today who are they defending and who are they attacking? They are still trying desperately to capture, recapture that whole power.
And argue, debate. Have we lost the debate?
I never said don't talk about the past.
I'm saying,
don't be stuck in the past. Yes. Talk about the present. I keep saying,
the whole
we must talk about the past.
Vapasi brigade.
But don't be stuck in it.
Vapasi gang.
Half an hour ago, you were saying, let's not talk about the past.
No, okay, I never said so.
Who's debating?
Arnab, roll back the tape.
Two of you debate. Who's debating? Nilanjan and Madhu are debating, I feel. Nilanjan and Madhu are debating.
At that time, the Lutyens mafia covered up the crimes of Nehru Gandhi dynasty. There were thousands of riots prior to 2002, and they were all covered up. But now, what are they doing? They are creating, cooking up a false narrative, as in the case of all these attacks on churches. If there is an electric electric short circuit, you call it an attack. If there was a theft by an accountant in a church, you called it an attack on churches.
The lynchestan.
Oh, there's the lynchestan.
And the lie. And the lie. And the lie.
One year, yes. There have been 100 attacks by Muslim mobs.
But here's my question.
36 attacks on Dalits in the last 6 months by Muslim mobs.
But,
you only talk of the ones with Hindu mobs.
How
the selectivity.
Weak, how weak
this propaganda.
Is the present administration?
But, no.
With the truth.
You killed Merit, and I, when this Judge Lawyer case happened.
Yeah, the media decided.
And organizations picked up the Judge Lawyer as a case in point. Loose construction of fact, rumors, no facts, nothing but, and constant assertion as if it were the truth. And I said in my last debate, I said the frustration of the Lutyen circle is it does not control the narrative. Earlier it used to be,
You're wrong. Social media is the one that...
I said to myself, what did this Lutyens League do when Justice H.R. Khanna, who upheld the integrity of the Constitution, was
superseded,
insulted.
Punished.
He was deprived of his position for the Chief Justice of India in 1977 by the Indira Gandhi regime. What did they do? They just stood around there and they clapped.
Who was the chief election commissioner?
How shameful is that? And those same people who participated in that murder of the judiciary, institutions and democracy are now complaining that they can't use cash anymore.
The man indicted by
the cash economy is gone.
Mr. Chawla. He became the chief election commissioner.
Rajiv, do you have no argument? We lost the debate.
So I want a 1:1 with Mr. Desai because I want to ask him a question. I want to ask him a question because
you've got to say something. This is your. This is the.
No, it's very afferent. Mr. Desai. Mr. Desai.
If you wanted to debate,
this is the family.
I thought it was a good debate. This Lutyens thing was a really good debate because if we're going to debate this issue of privilege and what that privilege promoted, which Stavleen knows I've written about, which is socialism and so forth.
Kathleen does not know this.
You quoted, you used my name
in your article.
Okay, anyway,
I've never heard you criticize Lutyens Delhi, by the way.
We were talking about privilege.
I've never heard you criticize privilege.
I use the word privilege and say I've written in the Wall Street Journal, I've written in the Times of India.
Mr. Desai, you were the media advisor to Rajiv Gandhi when the Beaufort story was breaking.
No, I wasn't.
And you were the man on national television.
It is on your company's.
I wasn't here.
I just saw it on your company. Your biography.
Yes.
Your biography of your company's website says.
Okay, who's debating? Who's debating it?
I want to
have a Rajiv.
I need to ask him a question.
Rajiv. Anand here.
It's very apparent.
Once a one-on-one debate with you, I allow it for the next
one. Because all of us, rightly so, criticize Indira Gandhi because there is one thing to look at, which is emergency. Who we don't criticize and who we think as the paragon of freedom of expression is Jawaharlal Nehru.
Yeah.
Now, I want to ask you,
democracy.
According to you, did Jawaharlal Nehru stifle freedom of speech and expression?
Rajiv,
yeah. Yes or no, sir?
No.
So now I need 30 seconds.
Anand and Rajiv are debating. Nobody else on the debate right now, please.
Mr. Desai said no.
Correct?
Yeah. Now, give me 30 seconds, Arnab, okay?
I give you more, though you don't give me, but continue.
This is under Jawaharlal Nehru, sir. Majru got jailed for writing a poem. Ramesh Sehgal was asked to delete lines from his film. Sahir Ludhianvi's song was censored. Pradeep's entire song in Amar Rahe Ya Pyar was axed. Two entire songs from Phir Subah Hogi were banned. Robson's 9 Hours to Rama was banned.
Yeah.
An Area of Darkness was banned. Naipaul's book. Campbell's The Heart of India was banned.
Andy, you forgot
Kostler's
Andy.
That is later. Yeah, that is his daughter, right? Campbell's The Heart of India was banned. Kostler's The Lotus and the Robot was banned.
Yeah.
Frischer's Aisha was banned. Russell's Unarmed Victory was banned.
Right.
Chandan Mohini and Mukesh of Somnath were banned. Taylor's The Dark Earth was banned. Selling Lady Chatelier's Lover was banned.
Yeah, that's true.
What Has Religion Done for Mankind was banned. Ravatnak's Bhupat Singh was banned. Baig's Captive Kashmir was banned. Mrinal Sen's Neil Akshar Nietzsche was banned. Audrey Menon's Rama Retold was banned. Tony Hagen's Nepal was banned. The organizer was censored. Publishers prosecuted. Film Gokul Shankar was banned. Godse's Testimony was banned. Goswami's film Rumi was banned. Nothing to do with you, Mr. Goswami. Not you.
Right,
film Bhool Na Jana was blocked. President Rajinder Prasad's
Rajiv
speech.
Rajiv, debate or lose the debate.
President Rajinder Prasad's speech was barred from distribution. Harmonium was banned. From from AIR, Harmonium, Draconian Press Objection Matter Act was passed, so column name Gowala was fired, magazine Crossroads was banned. Hindi film songs were banned from AIR, film Nasty was banned, pop rock music was banned from AIR, Play Harpita Master was banned, film Ganga Jamuna was blocked, Sarat Chandra Chattopadhyay's Play Mahesh was banned, Balraj Sami,
what's to argue?
Editor Pralad Keshav was banned.
What he's saying is not debating with
and
you.
And I asked you 30 seconds ago, do you believe Jawaharlal Nehru did anything against? And you said no.
Yes.
You still stick by that?
I
answer
agree
me,
with
sir, yes or no.
Okay, now you have to say it, but you have to give him his turn.
What am I?
Say yes or no.
Quiet, please, Rajiv. But all I'm saying
this is why I'm saying this.
You're using
airbrush history, you will repeat it.
None of it should happen.
Talk about the present. Of course,
it's happening in spades. It's happening in spades.
Okay, let him
read. One minute.
Does not mean that we cannot raise a voice.
Okay, 1 second. Anand, you're debating with Tavleen now. Everyone hold back. Anand and Tavleen. Tavleen's responding to you. Tavleen is responding. Nilanjan, hold back. Nilanjan, hold back. Yeah, let Tavleen come in. Yeah.
Let me tell you, my friend, that I am no great supporter of the dynasty or anything like that.
You have been.
But Nehru, as far as
I
am concerned, has been a great prime minister of this country. Nehru, yes.
Oh.
Because, and I totally oppose his...
Nehru was a public sector unit.
1 minute, I'm speaking.
Please.
Right? 1 minute, I am...
Okay, she's speaking.
I'm not going to speak it, but 1 minute, I'm speaking and I want the floor. All right, he made many mistakes. There is no question about that. And to me, the worst mistakes he made were economic ones. But what he laid at a very troubled time with dictatorships all around us, that he did do his best to keep democracy.
By whose standards?
In India.
By whose standards?
And
we
need to remember that and respect him.
No, we don't need. I give a specific example back to her at this time. Can I tell you? Institutionalized corruption, cheating the people of India, loot of this country.
His daughter.
Allow me. No, him. Tavleen, you don't know history.
It's very...
I'm sorry. Anand, you have been reading Romila Thapar's history. Let me tell you, Tavleen, the real history should have had...
Can I count it up, please?
Tavleen, you don't know history. I'll tell you one thing. This is not ancient. This is not ancient history. We come from ancient to present. I'm sorry. The Jeep scam happened. And then you are not interested in the present. You know, I'll come to the present also. I will, of course. But then, why are you getting uncomfortable? Every time, the Jeep scam happened. V.K. Krishnamenan, the then Indian High Commissioner to Britain, was accused of ignoring protocols and corruption. What did Nehru do?
By the son-in-law.
What questions were asked? What campaigns were run? You cheated the country, you did corruption in the name of the army, and now you're saying he built a legacy. See, Tavleen, now I come to the most critical issue here today. You said, and who supported all of this grime and muck? Who supported it? I say the Lutyens media supported it. The present Lutyens media.
Let me complete.
I now come into the good point. Everything that happened, the corruption, the killings, the massacre, the sterilizations, all happened because it had the support of the media at that time.
True.
The media at that time would write books, write on books and literature and culture and food, but they would not do any real journalism. Tavleen, you said, I think May 2017, you said, for the record, there are no Lutyens journalists, only good journalists and bad journalists. Tavleen, with all due respect, I think you're completely wrong. There are Lutyens journalists. Because if there were no Lutyens journalists, simply the scams wouldn't have taken these many decades to uncover. First assertion on that. I hope you agree with me on that.
I don't.
You want a definition?
When you talk about, as I said to you, I invented this Lutyens thing and I really regret it. When you talk about Lutyens Delhi, if you're talking about journalists who have privileged access,
no,
what they is existed access? Before, they exist now.
No, I don't. No. I don't.
They exist now.
It's true.
There are.
But
access doesn't mean anything. It's okay.
I
if you're a good journalist, you will get some privileged access. That's not the point. Wait a minute.
Good journalists don't get it.
Wait, I'm saying access.
Okay, Madhu is debating. Okay, Madhu is debating with.
Something else.
Okay, the debate now moves to Lutyens Media. By the way, I'm just saying to the viewers, now we are on the part where we're discussing the Lutyens Media. Now we are going to come to the part. Do not pull your punches. And I have some surprises also on this part of the debate.
Yes.
Can I define a Lutyens journalist, first please. Of all? May I, please? You see, I don't oversimplify this. I don't, by Lutyens Media, I don't mean people who operate out of Delhi. I don't mean people who have access. I mean people who have betrayed India. I mean the traitors to journalism. It's as clear as that. A Lutyens Media journalist is one, Tavleen, who is embroiled without questioning those they are embroiled with. A Lutyens Media journalist is one whose contribution is restricted to pontification and flowery analysis and unsubstantiated facts played up by hyperbole and sedated by their hypocrisy. I want a more clear definition of it. So I'll tell you one thing. A Lutyens Media journalist is one who knows everything, but because of that quote-unquote access, as long as you get invited to the parties, etc., what you call fly-on-the-wall journalism, which is not. I mean, fly-on-the-wall journalism, what's the point of it? I provoke you a little bit more. And my questions to the Lutyen side is simply this, that you know you cheated India because you did not report on a single scam for 70 years of this country's most corrupt history. And specifically, I would say, to you, I would say, what has Lutyens Delhi ever done? What has Lutyens Media, besides Sucheta Dalal and Chitra Subramaniam? I'm now placing individuals on record. Sucheta Dalal, though I disagree with her on many things, I respect her for her revelations on the Harshad Mehta scam and Chitra Subramaniam, I would say the greatest reporter this country has brought in, someone who should be celebrated in the corridors of India. These two people, besides Chitra Subramaniam and Sucheta Dalal, when did Lutyens Media ever break a story? When did Lutyens Media ever do a journalist's job? Dig out a story, demand accountability and answers. Where was the pang to be the fourth birth. Pillar?
Arnab, they were deciding cabinet.
Where was the pang? Where was the one pang second. to be a fourth pillar instead of a mute spectator and flowery descriptor of the three pillars?
If it had not been for my personal journalism, the please, story of Bhindranwale may never have come out. I did the first interview. In Kashmir,
when was there any journalism?
I even wrote a book. Shekhar Gupta revealed that the Indian army was training, Prabhakar. There have been millions of stories.
Ma'am, you wrote about Quatroki in 1999.
Don't talk rubbish.
Why?
Okay, Let him debate for a while.
Please, Anand and Tavleen. What's your point?
There is no doubt about it. There is absolutely no doubt about it.
In the 80s, you have not read them. If you had read them, you would not notice. It's about the media.
Can I just say something? When you talked about Chitra, when you talked about Sucheta,
Where are they? Where, who? Why is it that Chitra and Sucheta are really not in any power position as far as the media is concerned? More importantly,
Why aren't you allowing her to speak? It's hurting you, Rajiv.
When we started when I started Manushi in 1979, why did we do that? Because we did a study of newspapers and we found 70% at least is press release journalism from 5 kilometer radius of New Delhi. The press reaches other parts of India only when there is some great tragedy. There's some, somebody burnt, or there's some caste war, or there's a huge cataclysmic event. Otherwise, even 70 kilometers from New Delhi, people don't go unless there's a riot or some sensational...
The point I'm trying to make is,
they used to, what were then called expose journalism, were mostly leaks by rival politicians against each other. That's the only time we heard...
Madhu,
today what we have is just newspapers have deliberately become crime bulletins because they want to communicate that under BJP and under this regime, all that
will,
is happening in India is crime.
But when we speak
and
about when we
deliberate.
Speak about the legacy
it's
of
not
when we speak
anymore.
About the legacy of Lutyens media. If there is one institution which has betrayed India, it is the media. So all those people who are pretending to be journalists, while Tavleen, Rajiv and Nilanjan, you may defend this in the name of some fly on the wall or access journalism, I beg to differ, because for everyone who saw what journalists in those 5 or 6 decades of Congress rule did, what contribution to journalism, what contribution to India, what contribution to the pursuit of the truth. You can say I reported Bindranwale, I reported the Nelly massacre. That was not. See, why don't you ask yourself that more basic question, Tavleen? And I'll ask you this, that apart from Chitra Subramaniam, who used her skill as a journalist to secure 350 documents that detail the payoffs in the Bofors camp, what real expose did Lutyens media do? Did Lutyens media break the CWG scam? Could they have? Yes. Their sources were deep. Yes. Did they do that? No. Did Lutyens media break Colgate? Could they have? Yes. Did they do it? No. Did Lutyens media campaign even for the women who were fighting for triple talaq to enter Haji Ali Shrine to speak about the Sabarimalai temple? No. Could they have? Yes. Did they opportunities? Yes. Did they do any activist or impact journalism? No. Absolutely none. And all these years. And please, the worst thing, Tavleen, that you can do today is be in denial. This whole access is useless unless it is aimed at doing something, you know, making a change, asking the tough questions. What did anyone report on? I would even go on to the extent of saying this. Please don't mind my saying it. Since Lutyens has a checklist on lynchings today, and it has to say that every victim of lynching has to be a Muslim, it has to be an attack on freedom of expression, then let me ask you, what did you do when Safdar Hashmi was killed by the Congress party in 1989? Yeah. A 34-year-old, brilliant activist, poet, right, and theatre personality killed on a street, 1989. When that happened, where was the activism? Today, if that were to happen, I would say, you know, there would be 6 months of questioning on that subject. Absolutely not. Please understand, and I want to tell you today, Tavleen, do not be in denial about the disservice that Lutyens media has done to this country.
1 minute, on corruption and on speaking truth to power, they have failed this country.
None.
But to say
Nehru's blunders on China.
What has that got to do with what we're talking about? You're going on. Why are you calling him the greatest statesman that India ever witnessed?
I said
he was a great prime minister and we should respect him
because,
for it. All right, Madhu, we're not talking about Nehru now.
No, but you made a
everything goes
unchallenged.
No, I'm sorry, it's not possible to have a debate with somebody who changes the subject.
Change the subject.
The subject was the media. What are you going on about, Nehru?
I'm going on about Nehru.
Let's talk about media. Okay, don't get irritated with each other, please.
You're tying the media to the apron strings of Nehru. Tying the media to the apron strings of the government, during Nehru's time.
But she's going on about
Nehru. Hello. Even tying.
She says you're changing the
goalposts. Tying the media to the apron strings of Nehru and the state.
Nuisance.
No, you're going on. You don't listen. You talk too much.
That's why people get tired. Now shut up for a minute.
Oh, God, please.
Listen,
everyone,
shut up yourself.
Okay, calm down, everyone. No. Stay on the issue. We're discussing the
news. Institutionalizing the slavery of the media happened during Nehru's time.
Yes. I'm not speaking
because,
to this woman.
No, because
I refuse to speak to somebody who abuses me.
Okay, there's no abuse going on.
Television.
Okay,
talk
that
yourself.
Part is over. I also continue. Please continue. Let's carry on. Wow, one second.
I'm not even talking to you.
Can I bring in someone at this stage of the debate who is very important? I want to bring into the debate right now. I have the greatest pleasure of bringing into the debate the consulting editor of Republic TV, Chitra Subramaniam. She's on the debate. She's joining us right now. First of all, round of applause to Chitra out there for all the great work that we've done. And I, you know, Chitra, we admire you a great deal. And I can't discuss Lutyens media without having you on the program. And I began with a premise today where I'm saying, what service has Lutyens media ever done for India apart from betray India for about 60 or 70 years? Chitra, what do you think? Can I just bring you in and then we'll carry on the debate? Chitra.
No, I mean, the whole thing about Bofors, I didn't get up in the morning and say, I have to go to Rajiv Gandhi. No, I was not trained like that. But thank you for the compliments. For me, the Lutyens media is Windows. An absolute demonstration of access without responsibility. One, and you know, in my mind, there is in this entire thing, there are like bronze medalists, silver medalists, and gold medalists, and then there is like the platinum gang. So for me, these, you know, the bronze medalists, people who arrive from, let's say, you know, people who arrive in Delhi and see that there is this gang operating, and then they want to attach themselves to this gang, and the gang loves to use them as minions and, you know, eat it of crumbs. Then a silver medal, you become get a club membership, anyone, and you know, there are not too many in Delhi, so you can go and you make up stories, you have coffee and all that. And the gold medal is when you yourself get the bronze medalists in, and then it's like, you know, you get your free house, your free this, your free that. By this time, you stop being a journalist. And now, thanks to media, you know, you're now a content provider. Forget the journalists. And then, of course, the super, super stuff is it Rajiv Gandhi membership you become. Jeez. What have they done in the meantime? They have done nothing. There's no mentoring. I've never seen journalists mentor someone who bring them up, because they're also envious of each other. They're all envious. But in the meantime, and maybe 15, 20 years have passed, Lutyens has children. So children of Lutyens continue this thing, and that's, you know, we see it when, I mean, minister's kid slaps somebody, or, you know, do you know who I am kind of nonsense. And someone just said, and I, since I can't see you all, someone on the show just said that, what kind of India do we want? And my, you know, my whole thing was, who on earth do we think we are to even go that way and say, what is the India we want? India will get what Indians want, not a group of people who are completely cut off from each other and yet who live in suspicion and fear. Talking of fear, now everybody who's talking of fear today, and it's a projection, there's an entire study in psychiatry which say that what you have, you claim it in others. So the fear comes from, I don't think that the Lutyens media has become less. I think they are scared of having to grow back the bronze medal, or maybe not even a medal. So this is the whole cabal is very active. I don't think they're not active, but what to be active about? You know, what can they say that nobody else can deny? Then talk about mahol, the atmosphere, the emergency, and all of that. And it all sounds very fancy, because their children have also grown up with that, you see. If you have raised your children and they've only watched my bad stuff, then they will repeat it. So yes, now, you know, for me, Lutyens is, in my head, has been irrelevant for a long time. And, you know, I mean, okay, thanks for the Bofors thing. I didn't need any of them. I mean, I wasn't interested in meeting anybody more than just professionally. See, but no, I don't go to parties. No, yeah. I don't.
It's a very strong point. You know,
I don't go to parties.
I give one example
and
here,
now,
Chitra.
You know, I just don't go. Yeah. And then there is a silly thing. Oh, you know, all your work came for nothing. But I mean, this is the stupidest thing that people can tell me.
Chitra, when we speak about Lutyens media, and we take an example of the Radia tapes. And Rajiv and Tavleen and Nilanjan, apart from cheering on.
I have one more point to add.
Yeah, you want? Yeah, go on. Please do respond after she.
I have one more point put in. So this, you know, this Lutyens thing has journalists, politicians, lawyers, NGOs, and business people. Mm. Okay? And then there are Lutyenses in Bangalore, in Chennai, wherever. I mean, we know who they are. Mm. And they only meet each other. And anybody who comes from the outside, they feel threatened.
Hmm.
Well, I mean, you know, I took the example on the radia.
I disagree with a single point which Chitra
But then what did anyone do on the radia tapes? You see, apart from cheering on certain TV journalists whose names had come up, when the tapes of the radia tapes, I'm not even talking about the fact that there was no real investigative journalism apart from these couple of stories. There was no expose. There was nothing which 60 years, you have a bunch of journalists in a democracy, in a thriving democracy, all that they use, they suck the life out of this democracy to get benefits for themselves and favors. Half of them turned into contractors. And I'm not even asking what you did, but I'm asking today, genuinely I'm saying, when there were tapes in the public domain between Neera Radia, an intermediary, and an acquaintance of Telecom Minister A. Raja and certain journalists, what were the journalistic ethics on the story?
I want to go back.
No, what? Why was it buried?
I first want to.
When a certain journalist was taking editorial instructions from Neera Radia, then where did they lose their journalistic gut to protest about it? Where were the candlelight vigils or the black screens
in the same channel? And the man who published the story, Arnab, you know, was actually blocked from that channel. Vinod Mehta.
Vinod Mehta.
You were talking about.
No, you debate with him. I'm on Lutyens Media now.
You talked about Safdar Hashmi's murder by the Congress goons. What did the media do? Can I just remind you that on the 1st of January 1988, Lutyens Delhi was shut down.
How many awards were returned?
When the entire media, entire
how many awards were returned? Nilanjan, how many awards were returned?
Just a second.
How many signature campaigns happened?
They bought them over. They bought over CPM. They gave big money.
You know, Madhu might have a disagreement.
Madhu is countering.
Madhu has a disagreement with everybody. You talked about Safdar Hashmi. What did it do? I am pointing out that what it did, it stood out and it stood in
it
protest.
Did not at all.
And it stood
it
in
not.
Protest periodically.
It got co-opted.
It was not just.
It was co-opted.
No, within a few
that is your opinion. I did
it's not my
that.
Opinion. It's a fact. There were no candlelight vigils. There were no protest marches.
I think the media in India has.
You murdered Safdar Hashmi on the streets and no awards were returned. Which award was returned? Co-opted means you do a sort of co-opted means this. It means you do a protest and then life moves on, because as long as your positions and power access,
I think that's
houses
what's happening here today.
No, I'm telling you clearly
what
why did it not matter at all?
It's still happening.
How many awards
by
were returned? How many
still,
awards
there
were returned?
Are journalists in
how many awards
Delhi
were
who have access
how many awards
in exactly
were
the same
how
way.
How many awards were returned on Safdar Hashmi?
There were no
Congress
awards returned because journalists didn't have many
over.
Awards
that
to return.
Madhu is countering.
See,
Madhu.
What happened very soon.
I don't want to speak to her.
Why don't you want
no,
to speak?
No, because she's rude.
No, she's not being rude.
That's very unfair.
And I'm not going to speak to you.
She's part of my team and that's very unfair.
I'm
sorry, I object.
Okay, we'll edit the shut up part, now can we continue?
No, I want it shown on television.
Of course, people will see who was ruder. And Tavleen, let's stop.
I don't
let's
want to
stop
speak
it.
To her, Madhu.
I'm not speaking to you,
yeah.
I refuse to speak
who's
to
her. Who's speaking to you?
No, please discuss
I'm speaking
issues.
To okay, Tavleen.
I'm not going
Tavleen,
to.
Tavleen, we discuss issues.
I'm not going to. Tavleen, we discuss issues. I'm not going to. I'm not going to. I'm not going to. I'm not going to.
Okay, come on, calm down. Okay, please.
Arnab,
no,
you mentioned one.
Wait, let me
debate not, with Nilanjan.
Okay, let's have a hot debate, not a personal.
But I wanted
I
to talk
mind.
About the Safdar Hashmi thing. I was a witness to that whole movement.
To what?
And I think what happened within no time is that the Congress very astutely gave them huge amounts of money to set up Sehmat and Safdar Hashmi Trust, and thereafter it became actually
a front
organization.
We are not talking about Sehmat, we are talking about the immediate
Safdar
protest.
Hashmi.
Arnab raised the point that no one protested. I just pointed out the story
that's
ends there.
That's part of Lutyens' culture. That almost like blood money, it was taken, and thereafter Sehmat became a handmaiden, a front organization of the Congress Party.
The point is relevant.
On the Ram Mandir issue, on their entire political campaign against the Sangh Parivar, against Vajpayee's coming to power.
They did it for money.
One example I need to make, because I think that's very
making
pertinent.
The point
Arnab, you talked about Hashmi, right? Let me tell you
many
much
examples.
Okay,
right.
One to one, right. Now, how many people actually debated this or knew about this or wrote about this on the night of the Bhopal gas disaster?
Correct.
All right? Arjun Singh, who was the chief minister, physically gave orders to stop people from fleeing from Bhopal because he did not want Rajiv Gandhi to know the scale of the disaster.
Shame.
When we talk of Anderson, I don't mind Anderson. He's a crook. He escaped. Who let Anderson escape? Why is this nonsense? These are documented facts. Rajiv, I'm appalled to think of this as nonsense. What you were the advisor to Rajiv Gandhi. Who let Anderson escape?
Respond.
Who gave orders to not let people leave Bhopal?
Let him respond.
Let him respond.
Suhail, come in here.
Let him respond. Arjun Singh mentioned
yes.
in his own biography.
This is appalling.
Okay, respond.
It's not a manufactured...
I'm listening to what he's saying. Do you have a counter? He says...
No, you said that's nonsense.
Arjun Singh has mentioned...
Rajiv Gandhi went to Bhopal. What are you saying? In the middle of his campaign, he went to Bhopal.
He went to Bhopal to what? Free Anderson?
No.
I'm talking of different examples.
At the time of the disaster, what... Please.
No, look. Either you can rebut on facts...
No, I am rebutting my facts.
No, you
did go to Bhopal.
Do you deny that Arjun Singh specifically asked?
I don't know.
In his biography, Arjun Singh didn't whisper it into my ear while
How
we
did,
were.
And, but you were the advisor to Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. You would know who let Anderson out. Who let him out?
Why would I know?
Why wouldn't you? You're a student of history as well. According to you,
the question
was the government to blame?
Rajiv Gandhi went to Bhopal.
Was Rajiv Gandhi to blame for the escape of Anderson? Was he to blame, sir? Yes or no?
Just change the subject.
Much more importantly, Rajiv Gandhi was to blame for not allowing the victims of the Bhopal tragedy to get the money that was owed to them.
$470 million in that time.
It hasn't come to them.
Yes.
All right. And Rajiv Gandhi was to blame for
that. And the media was dreadful. That is why I'm saying we need to... The media did not follow the story up.
And the media was prevented.
Let her complete.
No. So, sir,
let her complete.
Arjun Singh was very powerful with a huge group of journalists who you actually can't call, Amit Shah certainly has his own thing, but the media
failed
in its role to tell that story.
But when you do it, then it's not what about it.
No, Arjun Singh was actually the first
disaster taking place under Amit Shah's nose.
I now come to the root issue. And we'll debate politely at this part. I just want to make a small observation here that India began changing. And I saw it when around the time we were in college, we were the post-reforms generation, we came in after reforms. We saw India change. Late 90s, when we were out in jobs, were the periods of opportunity. 2000s, I'm telling you, this whole lobby, and I mean to say this with great politeness, Rajiv, don't look at me in this hemorrhaging manner that you are.
Hemorrhaging.
I'm just saying it. You see, Rajiv, this lobby of which you are an esteemed member is like a dinosaur. It became extinct as soon as the economy opened up, as soon as the structure of economic fluidity started to come into India. This lobby became extinct. And Tavli knows it. The emergence of satellite television, the opening up of the economy.
Arnab, the person who led the attacks against the socialist state was me. I wrote articles in the Times of India in the second section.
You know
section
what Congress did to P.V. Narasimha Rao? Talk about that.
I'm just talking about opening up.
Did you ever advise Rajiv Gandhi to get rid of the license, Raj? Since you're such a keen anti-socialist.
Of course.
Why did he do that?
So you were an advisor.
He could have done that. He could have ended the license, Raj.
You came to that press conference. The first indicator of that was the entry of Pepsi. You came to the press conference in the Taj when we organized the press conference.
So, the entry of Pepsi with the license, Raj? No, there was no license. It started to open up. It was 91. It was finally in 91.
No, understand. I'm only making an observation before I go to the real issue of Modi. You see, I'm saying, don't get touchy. Economic liberalization, she's made a good point to you. The systematic dismantling of the license Raj that ruled the roost before 1990, it was a Lutyens concept. You all benefited. There were no entrepreneurs. There were no first generation entrepreneurs. There was no opportunity given out there. There wasn't any investment coming in. You know, you had messed the whole country up because of
Sanjay Lalbhai became the biggest producer of denim in the world.
Who became?
Mills.
You met Sanjay Gandhi, you got Maruti in. Listen to me. Vijay Mallya is an example.
An advocate of some line of thought, that's fine.
What line of thought?
The fact is, are you saying that the country didn't open up?
In 91,
I am saying, I am saying that on 26 September 2005, a Lutyens journalist whose name came up in the course of the Radia tapes wrote that Vijay Mallya never gets the respect he deserves from the business community. The system of currying of favors and giving of favors under the net of the law, and you know, another senior journalist who now has a some website called Print said that the Mallya story is more about the easy embrace of cronyism. In the name of socialistic protection, we have built up a giant permanent nexus of the powerful where contacts and network matter more than balance sheets. The fact of the matter is you have a problem with Modi today because he's going after people like Mallya, and Mallya is a symbol of that cronyism. Now I come to the issue of Modi. Nilanjan, I want to start with you. I get the feeling that the problem is Narendra Modi, and the problem is Narendra Modi, Narendra Modi, Narendra Modi, Narendra Modi, Narendra Modi, not even the BJP, but Narendra Modi, because the present Prime Minister is all about black and white. He's black and white about issues of India-Pakistan, black and white for his distaste of the Lutyen circuit. He's black and white, he's not got co-opted. Is Modi the problem? Is Modi the problem because favors have been cut off?
No,
Nilanjan.
No, I don't think favors have been cut off. It's just that one set of Darbaris have been replaced by another set of Darbaris. We talk about the Dun School. Dun School is being replaced, to talk it in terms of metaphor.
So can you tell
now,
me?
It's now the era of Saraswati Shishu Mandir.
Oh, come on.
What is it?
No, please don't say that.
With due respect to both teams, are we saying that Narendra Modi's government or the establishment today has no courtiers, has no sycophants, has no one?
No, I agree.
I'm not commenting on Saraswati
that's
Mandir.
All.
I'm just saying, are we saying that he has nothing and that he's squeaky?
There's no Darbar.
There are journalists and businessmen, and there are coteries that surround. Let her finish. Not Modi. Modi has no coterie. I don't think Modi sees anybody. I think he goes to bed at night. But I will say that as somebody who has supported Modi openly in my column, I get a lot of flack from colleagues, you know, for doing this
from
every
the Lutyen
day.
Circle,
every day.
Why is that?
Because
he's
you can openly support the Gandhi dynasty, as our friend here has done, but you cannot support Modi because of 2002. I began to support Modi because I felt that he was unfairly targeted on that. Can anybody name the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh when Hashimpura happened? I bet not.
I ask you
so
one question.
On Modi. Yeah.
Okay, Nilanjan, straight point.
No, but I need
straight,
to come.
Straight point. You made your recent reputation writing a book on Narendra Modi. Right? The problem is, you can write a book on Narendra Modi, but you can't influence him. Not you, but any number of people can write a book on Narendra Modi, but you can't influence him. The problem, therefore, is
that you didn't write a book that would please anybody. Just one point.
Swail, just one minute, please. You spread the negativity, but do you accept? Nilanjan. It's not a personal issue. The fact is that no matter the negativity you spread or the negativity you put out, the fact is there is a problem that the Lutyen circle has with Modi, that you can't co-opt him, which is a marked difference from the Congress regime. You cannot influence him. And if you cannot influence him, you don't have influence. I'll give you one example. You cannot influence him on cash, on slicing down the cash economy. It is famously said, Madhu, it is famously said that before demonetization was brought in at 8 o'clock on that particular evening in November, 8th of November 2008, apart from Narendra Modi, a handful of people knew. And
exactly.
The system therefore changes.
And he would not get influenced by anybody.
No, my question is, your inability to influence him, has it become the greatest weak point or sore point of the Lutyens media? Nilanjan, let's give an honest reply on this, please.
Sore?
Weak or sore? or both?
I think the problem is that he does not get influenced by anybody.
Why is that a problem? That's a good thing.
The problem is that people felt that he would be co-opted. The point is, I have a rider here. He has a right to reply.
He's revealing something.
Yet, the point is that Mr. Modi is a man who provides very simple solutions to very complex problems.
What's the problem with that? I'm not getting your issue.
The simple solutions do not provide any solutions to the complex problems.
I don't understand your issue. What was my question? I asked you a very simple question. I said to you, I repeat my point. Allow me, at the cost of laboring myself.
You're sounding like Mamata Banerjee, has a problem for every solution.
No, please don't compare me with Mamata Banerjee. I have sufficient reasons.
So, do not simplify this debate. I'm on a very moot point. And I want a serious issue on this. I do not want lightheartedness on this. I do not want
that Modi has simple solutions to complex problems. Is that worthy of being lauded or being criticized?
I ask you here once again. I repeat the question. So that
the problem is that Modi is not cooperating.
Let me steer this important part of the debate. We are therefore saying today, and any, you know, you don't even have to be a deep observer. You just look at it. There are n number of digital websites today who only live off articles saying Modi is bad on this, Modi is bad on this, his yoga is bad, his exercise regime is bad, his economy is bad, his clothes are bad, his hugging is bad. The question is, and you were revealing something very important. The question is that this is, you did accept, so please elaborate, that the real issue is that you cannot A, have access to this man, B, influence this man, C, establish who is his inner circle, and therefore, for a media that has only lived off the word that he uses, patronage, it's over.
No.
Nilanjan, it's over.
There are people within the media, there are people within the industry, there are people in other walks of life who have
What about the influence
access.
On Modi?
Who have selective access.
Now, Arnab, I need to make a couple of points.
They have selective
access. I'll come to Madhu.
Point one, you know, they have selective access.
What is the problem? What is the problem that the Lutyens circle has with Modi? Very honest reply.
The problem is
because
he can't be co-opted.
One set of people have been replaced by another set
of people.
So the previous set of people.
Can I get Rajiv on this? I'll come back to you. Rajiv, what is the problem that people have been?
You grabbed it and turned it around.
I have not grabbed a thing.
What he was saying is that Mr. Modi seems to have simplistic solutions to complex problems rather than simple. So that's really the only clarification I wanted to provide.
Simplistic is the right word for it.
And it's okay, we can
you
say that.
You see the suffocation that this Lutyens circle feels with Modi.
No, it has nothing to do with the suffocation.
Actually,
Why do you react to every word of mine? If you ask me...
They hate him.
Okay, right, Tavleen is speaking some truth. No, Tavleen.
Hate him.
Why do they hate him?
Because of what Manishankar Iyer so clearly said, he's a chaiwala who comes from a circle of people that they cannot co-opt. They can co-opt Mulayam Singh Yadav and they can co-opt Lalu Yadav, and they did. But Modi, they have been unable to absorb or co-opt.
And that's the reason why they hate him.
Arnab, I just want to make one serious comment.
I needed to make a point
the
5 minutes ago.
The issue with today's Lutyens so-called media is they have been marginalized because of indifference. Modi is indifferent to them.
The people are indifferent. People are indifferent.
You know, Anand talked about social media. People are indifferent to their opinions.
It's a supplement to the main news.
No, I go back.
That is how they make. But I won't rebut the appalling remark that you made before you said can't be co-opted. But I need to rebut Arnab on this. When he said Modi is not corrupt. When Malia escaped, who was in charge? Modi was, wasn't he? Most important point, the FCRA bill,
who got it amended retrospectively.
So corruption can be in cash or in kind. Someone who looks away, like Manmohan Singh looked away.
Anand, in my eyes, is as corrupt.
So I don't think the corruption has ebbed.
The allegation of a new coterie, the allegation being made here that there is a new coterie, it's simply whataboutry to deny that a Lutyens lobby has existed and flourished for decades. Now we are discussing Lutyens. What I'm saying is, what is the problem that this Lutyens lobby, which has flourished for decades, what problem does it have with Modi?
They don't have a space here.
They don't have a space.
They don't have space in this court.
You said they don't have space. They're not getting space here. Right?
Yeah.
No.
So if
they're not getting patronized.
They're not getting?
Patronized.
What kind of patronage? What kind of patronage do they expect? The government departments, the foreign trips.
But party bhi nahi hoti yaar.
The positions.
I think access is problem. Most important. For a journalist, access is more important. So you have a different set of journalists who get access.
Were they patronized during Vajpayee's regime?
No.
Yes, simple question.
Would it be fair to say then, and now we are on a very moot point. Nilanjan, would it be fair to say that because, and I'm linking one thing to the other with deductive reasoning, that you want patronage, you're not getting patronage, so you now say freedom of expression.
Well, I never got any patronage.
No, not you. Generally, the Lutyens group, because it's not getting patronage, you are now saying freedom of expression is going. Lynchings are happening. Is that true or not? Shashti Bharata was the only journalist. Allow me. You may know about him. Shashti Bharata was the only journalist to vociferously was vocal against Indira Gandhi's wrongs, and he was hounded out. I am asking you then, why was the great appreciation of the Congress freedom of expression? Which Lutyens media journalist stood up against it? And now I go back to the present and I link the past to the present. Because you have patronage then, you were silent on Shashti Bharata at that point of time. Because you don't have patronage now, hence you raise issues of lynching and freedom of expression. Am I correct or not?
If you're talking about opposition to...
I'm talking about Lutyens media.
In the media, during emergency... I do remember Mainstream, there's a small magazine which used to be brought out by Nikhil Chakravarti.
Yes.
With Soviet money.
That's Madhu's information.
And the Lutyens media. The communists were self-serving, hypocritical rascals.
We'll extend. I ask you this because, and I'm taking very clear examples out here, right? I'm linking the past to the present in a manner that you are not dialectically doing. You should be doing that. Otherwise, you would have said that last month after Shujaat Bukhari's killing.
Yeah.
When Shujaat Bukhari was killed, you provoke the Prime Minister and you say that the Prime Minister's Kashmir policy is playing right into the hands of the ISI. The Lashkar-e-Toyba was killing Kashmiri journalists. Nobody spoke about that at that point of time. Right. I am asking you very clearly that do you therefore concede this debate and lose this debate by admitting that the absence of the system of favors is the real reason for the selective reporting of the Lutyens media to make themselves relevant now?
No, you're talking.
Is it a battle for their survival?
Shujaat Bukhari, I think you know that there was.
I'm only giving. Specific example.
It is.
I'm giving you specific examples.
Here you prove Goswami, KGB, their anger is relevant.
You realize the KGB
printed 160,000 articles during Indira Gandhi's regime.
Oh, what's that?
Economic Times.
Anything from any
KGB
website.
KGB funded 40% of Indira Gandhi's MPs.
I'm sure you're reading out from somewhere.
CIA
you
archives.
Read out from anywhere. It can
archives
be
of CIA.
Be
I am asking you about the system of favors.
It is an archives written by a KGB spy master who names him.
I am asking you about this.
These
I am asking you.
Not where the money was.
Are you blindsided? Nilanjan. We are
in 1 year, 1972, KGB planted more than 3,500 articles in Indian newspapers.
Yeah.
Cambridge University archives. Now, are you saying that somebody else has gone and planted these things in the Cambridge University archives?
Why should I say
Come
that?
On.
I'm not saying it.
Then, no. Therefore, are we therefore in agreement right now that the Lutyens, that the Lutyens media, having done a disservice to India for 6 decades, is doing a second disservice to India because it's not getting patronized? Simple point. Yes, Chitra wants to come in on that. Chitra.
I want to make a point, Arnab.
Yeah, Chitra, go on. Yeah, sorry. Go on. You're on the debate. Sorry.
I want to make this point that they're also very casteist and misogyny. You know, there's a lot of misogyny and this whole caste system exists. I mean, if, you know, the Lutyens media was so concerned about Dalits, what were they doing till now? Brilliant. Look at the records, very valid, horribly skewed.
Brilliant point.
Media has primarily been upper caste dominated.
Just like the Communist Party.
Yeah.
Maybe like most parties.
Yes.
Not just the Communist Party. Why are you singling out the Congress
you
Party?
You have
Communist Party. The Congress Party, the Janata Party, every party.
Jyoti Basu, destroy industry in Bengal. I have no issues with the single
mall. You mentioned the media organization,
Arnab,
the print. A week ago, it ran an article talking about all the upper echelons of BJP, being anti, I mean, they're upper caste. They use this pejorative, according to me, Baniya, Brahmin, whatever, the whole party. Did they run an similar investigation on Congress and find out how many parties?
Or their
why
own
are only
paper?
You saying? Why are you talking about Communist Party?
So if I were to say today that is there a let me come right to the chase, Nilanjan.
Is that every question that we ask? You know, the point is that why did you not ask the same?
No, I'm not asking.
The point is that social dialectic,
the framework of analysis keeps evolving with time.
The questions that we are asking today will be insufficient tomorrow.
Nilanjan,
you do not understand the basics of social science.
Nilanjan.
Oh, because I'm
our
a scientist.
Tools keep on expanding.
I'm a scientist. No, I go by hard data. I go by previous citations.
You should understand the tools of our investigations keep on expanding.
If you are a scientist, you should know that.
Are you going to say, so what do you think of Allama Iqbal? What do you think of Sir Sayyid? Come on, tell me.
Don't ask these random questions which have no centrality to this debate.
It is central because for 60 years you were airbrushing, distorting history.
What relevance
are
you
distorting history?
What are you talking about? You know?
Mao killed 63 million people of his own people. You are supporting a party that has Mao on the wall.
I can also tell you, that.
Now comes what about
promoted, yes.
Now comes what about me?
You know, I'm not. You know, but I'm a Bengali,
why
so I'm passive.
He's not a communist.
Always
no,
passive like
saying,
a communist.
When I talked about
a lot of people watching this debate are looking at specific studies, case studies, and I think it will not be lost on the viewers of Republic today that there is a complete confession on the program today that we are Lutyens Media, we are not getting patronage, we're angry with Modi. He's not patronizing us. And therefore, I want to link it to this and you can deny or agree.
Allow me to complete.
I am only asking a question, he can deny it. See, I am not being unfair. I am saying here, the simple point is therefore, the Lutyens Media doesn't like Modi, he doesn't give access, he doesn't give patronage, he's a terrible fellow. Therefore, you want to say that Modi is therefore anti-Muslim, and therefore you will say under Modi, cows are more important than Muslims.
He has whatever political position from because of his political belief. He has a certain view of Indian nationalism.
No, tell me one statement of his which is anti-Muslim.
Match with Congress,
which is
therefore,
are you fighting an election battle?
His understanding
of
the,
Nilanjan, counter.
His view of nationalism, minus the histories, there are two ways of defining Indian nationhood in India.
There is one way which is that Indian nationalism is to be defined primarily on the cultural principle. It's called cultural nationalism. This is the kind of nationalism which was defined by Savarkar, by Hedgewar.
No, but let me also.
There is an alternative kind of a nationalism.
And this is the basic ideological divide.
I think everything points to
We are on the core point.
You do not want to talk about the core point that you have a different way of defining Indian nationalism.
Nilanjan. Listen. Yes, there are two versions of history. And what we
not
what,
history, there are two different streams ways of
all
defining
right,
who
streams
we
streams
are as a nation.
Arre bhaiya,
are we on the basis of a culture
right,
or are
right.
we on the basis
For
of the
you,
territory?
The Nehruvian.
No,
version,
don't bring in labels.
Please, let me
I'm
finish.
Talking you, concept of political science.
Why don't
Madhu,
please,
I'm trying to
don't give me elementary lessons
Nilanjan,
in
Nilanjan, simple question
science.
Can I put to you?
Let me finish.
Is the Lutyens Media is the Lutyens Media now actually really, really, really in the thick of the 2019 election fight, really hoping and really aggressively becoming a player. against Modi? Simple question.
No, I don't think
Forget
so.
Forget Modi. No,
I don't think so.
I think it's this.
You don't think so?
I don't think so.
Nilanjan, you wrote an article saying Mamata Banerjee looks to be the strongest candidate to take on Modi in 2019. You wrote that piece.
That's at the heart of it.
Quite some time ago.
You wrote a piece saying Mamata Banerjee is the strongest. Now, therefore, I want to ask you, which critical analysis has been done of Mamata Banerjee's declaration of a civil war in this country?
Well,
people are watching. Answer me.
On a television program, I have said that her views are alarmist. You have not
heard a political leader who you promote as prime minister wants a civil war in this country. Ask me one critical piece you've written.
It's highly unfair for you to raise the voice if you do not want to listen.
How is it unfair?
You say that.
I asked you about the most contemporary issue in NRC.
I've on a television program, I've said her views are alarmist. I think that's it.
Alarmist.
I have been critical. I've already stated it.
34% of the panchayat posts went unelected.
I have said
people were not allowed to contest the elections.
On a television program.
It is fascism what is happening in Bengal.
I am not writing an essay.
I am asking you a straight question. Asking you a straight question, sir.
Yes.
In according to you, who is displaying more fascist tendencies, Modi or Mamata? Straight question.
I don't think you can compare anybody on the
No, why not? Why Rajiv Desai writes
for
a piece? Rajiv Desai says it's a plan to throw out Bengali speaking people.
I have never called Modi a fascist.
Where
I have never
say
called.
That?
You do not understand possibly
where did I say
the depth
that?
Of what is the
no, you,
danger
you,
of fascism.
You, no, please.
I have never on record.
Emergency.
I have never said Modi is a fascist. I have never said.
Sir, khatre mein hai. What is all that?
And what has he done that is anti-Muslim?
Swastika, cartoons.
What has Modi done to deserve the label
so
as
I want to understand. Tavleen, I want to come
Mamata
to you. You've listened to this debate on Modi.
This debate was not going to lie.
The issue is on Modi. Therefore, I want to sum this up by saying, what is the problem that the Lutyens circle has with Modi? Is it a battle for survival? Is it really that if Modi were to come back, I want to put it simply, leave the theory. If Modi were to come back in 2019, then it's over. It's seeming to slip away. But if you were to come back in 2019, it's over. Therefore, the problem is not deeply ideological. One, it is not issue-based. It is not demographic. It's not even political. It is deeply a personal battle for survival for people like Rajiv.
For relevance.
What?
Why do you say survival? These people want to be relevant. They have been goaded, hurted.
Rajiv and Sohail.
I have nothing to say to these kinds of egregious remarks. Are you kidding me?
Come on, you can't put down
it's
a question.
I'm asking you a question.
What do you mean,
please
survival? You think we survive on the grace and...
Yes.
Media. He's talking about the media survival.
I'm talking of the circle as well. What did you say? I did say, Rajiv, are you in any doubt? I started by saying that you all have survived on the grace of the Nehru-Gandhi family and their psychophants.
That's not true.
Is there anything else you have to say?
What?
That's not true.
It's not true.
I've given a zillion examples.
Say anything more. I've told you, it's not true.
Personally, Rajiv could have survived anywhere.
Rajiv, do you realize in the course of the debate?
To survive.
But I didn't.
I agree.
Yeah, I don't need a
you
Congress
can survive
party to survive.
Anywhere,
are you kidding me?
In any regime, that's not the issue.
What he just said.
His affection had no material linkage.
That's absolutely.
Rajiv is trying to pretend, and I'll say it at the end, that he's not a player. Rajiv, you are fighting a battle for survival. You have gone ahead and said that Hindutva is a network of cults that may be embarked on a 21st century
that's
attempt to colonize India. What do you mean by saying that it's a version of colonization?
You have a point of view, I have a point of view. I can't express it.
No, you can, but I'm asking you, don't pretend that you're
not
a player. Why were you silent on the Hindu-Taliban problem?
I can write opinion pieces.
Surely you can.
Says, that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean I'm supping off a Congress table.
So you're free to write
that doesn't mean anything.
You're free to write whatever you want?
No, I'm free to write whatever I want, provided
it's reasonable. So there is no emergency then?
It's reasonable. Yeah.
Good. Good to know that.
Like there was no 1984, other than George Orwell.
Yeah.
On that note,
on that note, I give you one last chance to either of you, any of you, to rebut us on any factual point I've made on the
but
program.
But I thought you were on our side. You know, that's what Anand said. You're on our side.
I want to give you one opportunity to counter us on one fact. One fact which has been presented today on the program. Because we'll come to the voting.
You had your
people will be voting
Swami
and they will be watching.
Fine.
The subject of debate, therefore, is does India hate? Does India now hate the Lutyens circle? Do you therefore end by saying that, you know, you do agree with the proposition? Nilanjan.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. I think that there's...
I think we'll have to agree, you know, this is something, you know, which... You know, we have created a hate symbol. You have created a very very convenient hate symbol.
Crawling
Lely is another one.
As I said, that's the wrong word. It's irrelevant. But Arnab, I want to ask you something because you are a journalist. You're an honest journalist and I sincerely believe that. Have you ever, ever turned a blind eye watching a Lutyens media colleague do the Lutyens business? Yes or no?
I've never done that.
I know you have never done it. I'm asking a different question.
Nilanjan, why don't you ask me that question?
Have you been Manmohan Singh?
Nilanjan, see.
Why don't you ask?
Have you turned a blind eye?
Nilanjan, see. Nilanjan, see. Anand, sorry.
Yeah.
Anand, let me wrap up by saying here that I have observed the Lutyens media for a very long time.
Yes.
And I will say one thing, that the Lutyens media, and we can introspect on this point at the very end, never exposed one scam when Manmohan Singh was in power.
Correct.
And never exposed one scam when Modi was in power. We did expose both Sushma, Vasundhara, Lalit Modi when Modi was in power. And we exposed CWG when Modi was not in power. And hence, I have come of the clear belief that when you have not a grasshopper's point of view, right, but when you have a bird's eye point of view, you sometimes have from distance a little more objectivity. I'm a firm believer. You shake the media out of New Delhi and Gurgaon and Noida, you will have a better media in this country. That's my view since you wanted an answer. But I thank you all very much for joining me on this debate today. I know it's been a little chaotic and we've had multiple disagreements, but I think people will enjoy watching the debate. Thank you so much for joining me today. Thank you.